This video introduces you to one of the genres associated with Equiano's narrative, nonfiction. This week, in our turn to Equiano's narrative in Module 3, we shift from poetry to prose. While the Canterbury Tales and Shakespeare's sonnets are written according to various lyrical or rhythmic structures, Equiano's narrative is organized into books, chapters, and paragraphs that largely are written in sentences that more closely mirror actual speech. Because it purports to relate the actual history of Equiano's life, his text can be called nonfiction. As you may know, nonfiction is huge at the University of Iowa. We have the number one nonfiction MFA program in the U.S. One aspect of nonfiction that the program at Iowa has made clear is how nonfiction doesn't necessarily just mean facts. Rather, the idea of creative nonfiction is what many of the teachers think carefully about here. For many faculty, nonfiction isn't simply about relating hard facts, but rather engaging with those facts in a creative and literary way that at times even stretches the truth, all for the sake of a higher thematic goal. As I said, Iowa faculty are very interested in thinking about just what creative nonfiction is in a very self-conscious way. An example of this is the work of Iowa faculty member John DeGatta. In 2010, John published an essay in the journal The Believer about the culture of suicide in Las Vegas. The Believer hired a fact checker for John's essay. The fact checker constantly questioned John's claims, producing page after page of questions and challenges. John, always thinking in a brilliant meta way about the creative elements in nonfiction, published a book about his encounter with that zealous fact checker. The book, called The Lifespan of a Fact, put John's Believer piece about Vegas at the center of each page and then surrounded it with commentary from the fact checker. John received a lot of acclaim for that book. It even was adapted into a play that was performed on Broadway in 2018. And guess who starred as the fact checker? None other than Harry Potter himself, Daniel Radcliffe. I've discussed nonfiction at Iowa a bit. Because its stress on the creative dimensions of nonfiction is highly appropriate for Equiano's narrative. In his narrative, Equiano claims that he is an accurate eyewitness to what he describes. But the fact is, the narrative is also very literary. It engages with literary predecessors, including Shakespeare, and especially the 17th century writer, John Milton, whose great epic work, Paradise Lost, is cited often in the narrative. All of which is to say the shift to nonfiction in Module 3 does not mean in any way that Equiano's text is easier than earlier texts we've read in this class, or that it lends itself less to interpretation and analysis. I urge you to read Equiano's narrative closely in the manner that we have read Chaucer and Shakespeare. You can also associate Equiano's narrative with other subcategories of nonfiction, such as travelogue, adventure story, and economic treaties. In particular, Equiano's narrative is an autobiography, or what we might call today a memoir. Autobiography has a long history in the Christian West, going back to the late 4th century and the Confessions of Augustine of Hippo. Equiano's narrative, like Augustine's Confessions, is very much a Christian spiritual autobiography. That is, it follows a narrative pattern of sin, then repentance, some backsliding, and then finally a rebirth through a true and deep conversion to Christianity. With their thematic stress on salvation and belief in the Christian God, as well as the challenges facing all humans as sinners in a fallen world, spiritual autobiographies, in certain respects, take us to pre-humanism, and the emphasis in Chaucer's world upon the afterlife. But there is an important way in which autobiography speaks to humanism as well. For autobiography, of course, is the story of a person, and it often takes the reader into that person's mind. Autobiography, thus, in many respects, stresses the identity of the author as a self, as an individual, possessed of interiority and performing acts in this world. As you read Equiano's narrative, do consider how he follows the conventions of spiritual autobiography and how he attends to Christian issues, particularly as they are represented in the Bible, which Equiano knows very well and cites. Finally, consider how Equiano adapts the long-standing genre of the spiritual autobiography to fit the emerging nonfiction literary genre of the slave narrative. That is, how do elements of the story of a slave, freedom, enslavement, escape, and freedom, correspond to the main elements of a spiritual autobiography? That is, the shift from sin to conversion, and finally, rebirth.